last in the, this session, Professor Pinchas Alpert from Department of Geosciences, Earth Sciences, the Porter School of Environment, and he is going to talk about the reserve project. Please.
תראה לי איך זה עובד פה. איך?
ימינה וקדימה, אחורה.
קדימה, אחורה.
זה רק שנייה. תדבר למיקרופון אם אפשר.
היי. Thank you all. Wow. Okay. After dealing with what's going on deep in Earth and what's going on deep in our body, now I'm going to talk about what's happening, what is surrounding us, the air that is surrounding us. The DESERVE project is a project that went on for the last 5 years, and I want to describe it, funded by Helmholtz Association. I was asked last September to give the public talk on visions of research in the Middle East, the Israeli perspective. So when Mira contacted me, I thought about giving this lecture. But then I realized that I first have to describe what is DESERVE. This was my talk there in the final, in the public talk about DESERVE. If the time will allow, I will explain why the two lessons that I want, that I studied from DESERVE, are what will be the 21st century Mideast climate, and particularly in the Dead Sea region, and potential new aerosol source in the Eastern Mediterranean. But I will focus on DESERVE and go to the following. I was in charge on the work package 7, together with Uli Korsmeyer from Karlsruhe, which was climate, weather, and atmospheric hazards. And particularly, I want to mention a very exciting observation period in 2014 in the Dead Sea area. This is a general slide describing the DESERVE. As you can see, it includes everything complex, including the deep core that Tzvi talked about, including earthquakes that Hillel talked about, sinkholes, soil dynamics, water and soil. But I will focus on the climate, severe weather, and extreme events. These are the participants of DESERVE, which was a relatively large project of 3 million euro. And Christoph Kottemeyer was the speaker of this project. Fortunately, Christoph Kottemeyer is a climate and atmospheric scientist. So they've chosen me to lead it in this part in Israel. Large group of people, I will not go through the list, postdocs, many master students, many PhD students, I will show some of the works done here. The complex topography here is something that many talked about it, but the climate and the atmospheric features that are caused by such a complex topography is indeed extremely interesting. And amazingly, there were no observations in the atmosphere of the Dead Sea, not in extended length of about months that we have done here. For example, the problem of haze, haze layers, aerosol, different aerosol parts, which Zev was trying to study some time ago. And other questions, one other question that was not studied is the Mediterranean effect on the Dead Sea. The Mediterranean is generating a sea breeze that is climbing up the mountains and then drop into the Dead Sea area and causing a very unique climate and weather conditions. People don't know, but the strongest winds in Israel during summer are in the Dead Sea. Everybody coming to the Dead Sea area in the late evening in summer knows 10 meters per second is not unusual. But there is nowhere in Israel a place where we can reach such high speed velocities of the wind. Let me describe a little bit what was done in this observational period. Interesting, very interesting. It was supposed to start on the 8th of July, 2014. On that day, Tsuk Eitan started, which is the rockets from Gaza to Israel and to the Ashdod port. And after working for over a year, rockets hit the Ashdod port on the same morning that four huge trucks with all the system, the measurement systems, lidars that I will describe in a moment, were about to leave the Ashdod port. And because of that, the Ashdod was closed. And as for, I was praying that morning, as I was not praying for a long time, believe me, that it will open again. And I was so happy that there was an intermission of about 2 hours, and they opened the port again, and all the trucks with all the systems succeeded to leave the area and get to the Dead Sea. The main part of the measurements that I'm going to present are during this Tsuk Eitan, which is the period, the difficult period here of August 2014, the measurements. By the way, many of the Germans didn't come to Israel, and this system of measurements needed a large group of people, 24 hours to sit down, and several people from my group volunteered to go down, and they occupied the stations. There was another period which is supposed to represent the winter period, November. And let me show you what it includes. The long-term, the goals of these measurements were to estimate the Dead Sea evaporation and the water budget, what triggers precipitation, and the intensity of the Dead Sea haze. And measurement started already in February 2014. And the special observational period was to analyze the boundary layer processes and the regional and local wind systems using lidars and radars and microwave remote sensing and in situ measurements. 4 weeks in August 2014 and 4 weeks during November 2014. And additional measurements in Jordan and with the Palestine Authority. This is an example of a station that was established very close to here, the En Gedi Spa. It's an energy balance station, which we never had in Israel before. And we have 4 or 5 stations like this in the region of the Dead Sea. And I will show you some of the exciting results about what's happening in the climate and the weather here. These are the measurements. You can see the EBS, which is several of these. These are the 3 in Israel, in the En Gedi Spa, En Gedi Beach. And here, and several meteorological, very fine meteorological station, and the KIT cube, which is measuring a cube of 10 by 10 by 10 kilometers in the atmosphere with a lot of components. This is the, sorry, what happened here? Okay. Now, this is the instrument which is called the Energy Balance Station. It had the eddy covariance measurements, which measured the fluxes of water and of CO2 and the wind components, the three components of the winds and temperatures. These are the list, sorry again, these are the list of the measurements which were never done before in such an extensive way in several stations in the Dead Sea. Particularly exciting is the long wave incoming and outgoing radiation, high resolution, sensible and latent heat fluxes and momentum fluxes, and so on. These are some examples, for example, of the very high resolution measurements of the long wave and the short wave measurements every few seconds, air pressure, wind speeds, etc. This is few hundred meters from here. It's called the Opera site, where we established these four trucks arrived to here. You can see them here. And the type of measurements, which I will not go into all the details of this system, but the idea of this system, including sun photometer, sound, sodar, disdrometers, radio sound, every 2 hours for several weekends, cloud radar, oscillometer. I told them, why do you bring cloud radar? We don't have clouds here. But it happened. In November, we had several days of clouds. And this was operated. This is an example of the depth of the atmosphere going up even to 20 kilometers. But the whole idea of all these instruments is to cover the cube of a 10 by 10 by 10 kilometers in the atmosphere, never done in Israel before. It was done only in the Dead Sea. This is the kind of list of instruments, which, by the way, it costs several million euros. This is what I was thinking about, not the Germans, but I was thinking, wow, all this is going to be lost. But it worked, and we have the data, and we have many studies that I want to show you. This is one example from an instrument, which is the sound looking into up to several hundred meters from the opera site of the Mesada. And you can see here what I'm going to talk a little bit later is the dramatic change in the afternoon at around 17 hours, this is time in UTC, dramatic change into very strong winds from the northwest, which is called the Mediterranean Sea Breeze. And there is also a dramatic change that you can see in the humidity measurements from a radiometer that is going up to a few kilometers. This is the change in the humidity. Look what happens when the Mediterranean Sea Breeze arrives. Values of 10, 20, 12, 13 grams per meter cube of water in the atmosphere drop significantly in just few minutes with the arrival of this Mediterranean Sea Breeze. This drying is happening because when air drops from Jerusalem down to the Dead Sea, it warms and dries up. So you can see for the first time we were able to see what's happening in the atmosphere. It's unbelievable. This is another instrument which measures aerosol, optical thickness, for different wavelengths. Now, motivation from the Kit Cube was that we need to, by the way, I didn't mention, we have also in Jordan, in the Masada, the Kit Cube, and we have also radiosondes in El Mazra, and we have the three energy balance stations in Israel, and the very sophisticated meteorological stations. Now, let me show you just three examples of new monitoring that was not done before. One, we used a method that we developed using commercial cellular data, jointly with my colleague in the engineering faculty, Hagit Messer. We published it in 2006 in Science, Brivia, that we can use commercial cellular data to measure rainfall and to measure humidity in the atmosphere. We used it in the Dead Sea. We have this last weekend a flash flood in this region, in several locations, including Tse'elim. We focused on Tse'elim River, which had a flash flood. And this idea of using commercial cellular data is, first of all, we have minimal cost or no cost at all, because it's data collected by the commercial companies. And the measurements are taken at surface level between the antennas in the microwave, and they are widely spread, as I will show, compared to the classical systems. For example, looking in Israel, we have about 10,000 links that cover the area of Israel. This is a focus over Tel Aviv. And this is comparing the regular rain station, about 400 over all of Israel, to 10,000 links from the different, three different companies. This is an example of one result of a paper we published, that you can see the commercial microwave networks is producing a map of rainfall over Israel using 4,500 links, and we can see some high rainfall in the south, which is not covered in the Negev, not covered in the southern Negev, not covered not by radar, not by rain gauges. This is the example of the radar. You see, it does not cover this region here, which had a huge flood. This is an example in the Tse'elim River. And you can see here the accumulated rainfall, which reached 60 to 70 millimeters, which is a lot in the Tse'elim area. This was a severe flood. Compared, the links compared to the average two rain gauges that exist in this region. This is the map. These are one rain gauge. We are located here in the Masada and Tse'elim. This is the river of Tse'elim, and the link covers exactly the area which collects the rainfall for the Tse'elim floods. Now we are also showing that we can monitor the air humidity over Israel. This is over North Israel from links compared to weather stations and compared to something which is the best available in meteorology, which is the European Center ECMWF data. And it gives us, it provides us with much more detail. And when compared to weather stations, it is much more accurate. This is an example of showing the accuracy not published yet in two stations. The links provide us with 0.91 correlation to the stations, while the ECMWF lower value. This is another station. The second example that was motivated by deserve is the Silometer network, which are lidars, simple lidars that exist now in all airports in Israel, and they look upward to a few kilometers, and we can follow, for example, the depth of the planetary boundary layer, which is the nearest layer near the surface, which is so important for pollution and for other studies. And let me show you one result. This is for a big storm event, dust storm event, that covered all of Israel. Here are three different silometers. It was on September 2015, and it covers here 3 days. This is the Israel Met Service. You can see the dust going, coming down and covering the near surface. Airports were closed in Israel. Ben Gurion Airport was closed. You can see with this amount, which was very unusual event. And when we analyzed the 9 silometers that we have over Israel, for the how the planetary boundary layer is behaving, you can see here what we had until recently was only Tel Aviv. Beit Dagan. Beit Dagan silometer shows a diurnal change which is slightly increasing, but it's about 800 meters. And this is what we knew about the boundary layer in Israel, because this was the only radio sonde that measured the planetary boundary layer. Now, having these 9 silometers, we can see very different behavior in Jerusalem or in inland areas. And in the Dead Sea, we recently used the data from the Wind Tracer instrument, and we see large differences of the planetary boundary layer between different times of the day. This is the radiosonde depth. Look how it changes. During night, it goes down to a few hundred meters. And then in the morning, it's about 500 or so, or 600 meters. But later in the evening, when the Mediterranean sea breeze arrives, we have much higher planetary boundary layer. This is extremely important for understanding pollution in the Dead Sea, for understanding aerosols in the Dead Sea, for understanding evaporation in the Dead Sea, as we have shown in the studies. The last instrument which I want to show is a new that was developed through DESERVE, was a satellite product. Now looking not from below, like the silometer, but looking from above, from a MODIS instrument. It's called MAYAK product. MODIS is the name of the regular instrument, which is with resolution of 10 kilometers or 3 kilometers. The MAYAK is a product which reaches 1 by 1 kilometer. And let me show you some result for the Dead Sea. You can see here on the right side the 1 by 1 kilometer analysis of the aerosols in the Dead Sea area. This is the first time we could follow the pollution from local Dead Sea factories. They didn't like these results from the factories, of course, because we can now follow every day 1 by 1 kilometer where is the pollution. And another thing that we are doing now, looking on different days, this is the 10 by 10 kilometer, which is not available for the whole area, and this is 1 by 1 kilometer. This is one day in the 18th of August. You can see that most of the pollution is on the Israeli side. The Jordanian side is clean. On another day, which is the 15th of August, you can see the pollution in red on both sides. Now, and this is another day which is clean, 6th of August. Why are there such large differences between the two shores of the Dead Sea, the eastern side and the western side, and why we have days in which the western side is more polluted and the eastern side is clean, and the opposite? This is in the middle of a study. First paper was already published. You can see it here, it's in press. This is the study of the radiosondes, and this is study of the entrance. It was not published yet, but you can see, for example, here in the Engedi Spa or the Engedi Beach, you can see what happens. The red is after the Mediterranean sea breeze enters. This is an average for the whole month with 10-minute resolution. You can see the wind before it entered was from the northeast. After it entered, it's from the northwest. And the same for all other stations. And there are changes, significant changes in temperature. In red is the increase of temperature. It's in the evening, between 7:30 in the evening to 10 p.m. in the evening, and temperature increases. And also specific, in this case, you can see also the humidity changes, and you can also see the changes, humidity increases in some places and others not. Another study is running models for the dust pollution, and I will skip that. I want to get, yes, I'm finishing, okay. This is an example of the entrance of the sea breeze in from 11 GMT to 16 GMT. You can see what happens with models. And the last thing I want to show you is a project that came by, we deserve, school stations, school weather stations. Now, when you left the restaurant this morning, you know, across the street is a school in Engedi. 6 stations were put, and you can see one of these stations just across the restaurant. It's on the school, and children are working with this data and doing different projects. 2 such stations in Israeli schools, 2 in Palestinians, and 2 in Jordanians. Thank you.
Well, one question, please.
One question, okay.
I'm interested in the wind measurement. You know, the wind industry, the wind turbine industry, gave birth to a lot of evaluating companies, good ones, like Gerhard Hassan, and they have a lot of experience. You know, they view it commercially, but they have a lot of experience in measuring and give good indication for coming 20 years of behavior of weather, and almost all over the world. Do you have any contact with such companies?
My student developed a company, Yiftach Spector, is a former well-known pilot at Air Force. He was the vice director, I think, of the Air Force. And he developed a company following a master thesis that he did with me, using world radiosondes to find where are the best locations for wind turbines. And it works very nicely. I suggest I can make the contact between you.